I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
Psalm 46. just looking at those pictures, you brings obviously back lots of great memories, and no doubt there's a big hole that's left in your life, and it represents change, and a lot of times it's hard to adjust to that change. It's going to take time to adjust to that change, and that's exactly what the psalmist speaks about in Psalm 46. He speaks about even what we could refer to as cataclysmic change. Change is happening all around us, and this is the way he describes it. Where is it that we go to in a time of change? And he says, God is our refuge. He is our strength. He is a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains would slip into the heart of the sea, though its waters would roar and foam, though the mountains would quake with its swirling pride. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar, the kingdoms tottered. He raised his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come and behold the works of the Lord, who has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow, cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still. Know that I am God. I'll be exalted among the nations. I'll be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, it is to you that we turn. It is to you that we run. It is to you that we find refuge. We find strength. God, we, just like the psalmist tells us, God, there's a river that makes glad the city of God. And Lord, that river is nothing less than he who claimed to be the Son of God. God, that he promised to give for your Holy Spirit to come, and there would be waters that would be springing up from everlasting life. And God, they would flow in us and through us. And God, we pray, Lord, that those streams would flow in us now, even as we come together in the time of grief and loss. That, Father, we might be in touch with you and be filled with your Spirit as we not only reflect upon a wonderful, beautiful, fun-filled life, but also, Father, as we focus on your word and the hope that you give to us in Christ. I pray these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a couple of the family members that could come and share a few thoughts with you. So at this time, Mark.
On the way down the other day, I was on a phone call, hands-free, of course, with the meeting, Dr. Grimm. And they would ask me if anybody wants to say a few words, and I heard in the background my brother Terry say, Mark will talk. He likes to talk. So here I am. So, second of all, I wanted to thank my coach, speechwriter, Lydia Edmonds, great granddaughter. The other day I was writing it out, and she asked me what I was doing, and I told her what I was doing, and she wanted to hear it, so I kind of gave her the rough draft, and I asked her what it was that could make it better. And she got the pen, okay, and said, we need unicorns. So, unicorns is the way to go. Alright, now you get my rough draft. All right, my mom was a woman with a great passion for life. She was strong-willed and was not afraid of letting people know how she felt about anything. She loved playing games, especially cards. Some of her favorite games were 500 Rummy, Rope, Triply. Now, if you don't know about Triply, Triply is a card game in which it's poker and Michigan Rummy. And in the Michigan Rummy part, if you play all your cards, then you get a little special pot called the kitty. And whenever she went out, played all of her cards, there was a lot of excitement. And you also have to pay her one chip for every card you have, so that was always collected right up front. And then it was just, hee, kitty, kitty, kitty. Gone, and she scooped that those chips up, and they were hers. Now, at the time, it was like, for me, it was like fingernails on the chalkboard. Now, some of you younger folks probably don't know what that sounds like, so, but it's not a pleasant sound. It's like a very screeching pit. But years later, fast forward, playing with my own kids, right? Guess what I do? I play my last card, I play my money, and I say, hee, kitty, kitty, kitty. And they don't care like that much either, but 23 years from now, you might think of back on it with. Not as bad as it was at the time, or it still is, by the way. Okay. Moving on here. Mom also liked the bowl. She loved the bowl. And she loved sports in general. She was a basketball player when she was younger. And she loved college football, basketball, watched them all the time. Huge fan. And she was also a huge fan of myself. And all the kids, of course, but one kid was featured. She went all of our games. She was always there, shouting support. I remember basketball, especially because you're in that small gymnasium there with everything echoing off, everything. So you sit there and hear, Mark, get the ball! Get it in him! Don't let him shoot! And then, of course, if she didn't like a foul called on me, well, you can be sure that everybody in the gymnasium knew that that was not a foul. And it was a bad call by the referee, and never should have known. So, she was definitely a fan. She also loved holidays. Christmas, definitely her favorite. I can remember as a kid, excitement that was building up for Christmas Eve and then Christmas morning, and she loved to decorate. The house would be decorated with just everything. And then on Christmas morning, we'd all go down to the Christmas tree. There was presents everywhere, stockings were stuffed, and she just loved it. She could tell she just loved the joy of our joy. She continued to collect lots and lots of Christmas stuff over the years, and probably could decorate maybe half the houses in Roanoke at this point, but of all the stuff she collected. But she just really loved Christmas, and that was one of the things that definitely stood out with me with her. And then above all, she loved her family. She sometimes had a hard time saying it, but we knew she did. I'm not supposed to do this, but Sheree, one of the reasons Sheree said I could go first was so I could make you laugh. So I gotta hold that up. Okay, so she had a hard time saying sometimes, but later in life, she got better at it. She really loved my dad. And now, she can go back and be with my dad. And be at peace. I love you, Mom. I'll miss you. Alright, sorry, Sheree.
Our mama was a unique and special woman. a woman I admire and love for many reasons. Mom was a seamstress, a great cook, decorated the house for every holiday, a taxi driver for many, many years for the whole family, a cheerleader in the stands for all of our sports, countless hours of and memories of playing games, like across the nation, we played everywhere with all my friends and growing up and currently in New Mexico, every time we have a family vacation. Another thing we would love to do, she would go to the old stereo in the living room and crank up the music, and we would always have a dance party. And very, very passionate about animals, and her fur babies, she treated them just like any of us, which I currently do for my babies, so I understand that. She always loved being in style, and she actually loved the shop, but she, like, going through her house this past summer, it was like going through like decades and eras of purses and shoes and hats and dresses, and she just loved being fashionable and being part of, like, in style. She was always very young, even in her 80s, she still wanted to look fashionable, not something that she wore back in the day. So I love that about her too. And her hair changed all the time, all the time. She would change styles and colors, length. She wanted to be part of the hip era. So another thing I loved about her and my dad is they taught us love of the ocean, beach trips while we were growing up. And then we spent a lot of time with all of our families, if you know, saw on the slideshow, time at the beach. It's just something magical about the ocean and the sand and being together as a family. She was able, after I left, finally, after five kids, Dad and her were able to take cruises, which was something she treasured very, very much. You know, between great food and able to dress up fancy and go dance the night away every night, it was just a dream come true for them. They traveled through the Caribbean and a lot of other exotic places. Mom wasn't able to travel much when, as a little girl, you know, kind of thing. I think they went to Virginia Beach and a New York trip, but she never really got to explore the United States. So it was quite the fun times that we were able to go together with my family, or as all of our families got together, we traveled coast to coast. And from East Coast to the West, we got to explore all those places again, just through her eyes, because it was the first time she'd ever been. Las Vegas was a blast with Mom. And she was always wanting to laugh. She loved to laugh, and she loved to make other people laugh. Even in the nursing home, she was always very attentive to people and always kidding with the nurses and the staff. You never knew what would happen on an outing with Mom, but you could always count on fun and unforgettable moments at some point. She was the best kind of quirky, so conversations was always fun. For instance, a couple of years ago, I told her I was going skydiving, and I was kind of bracing myself for a lecture because she would be like, oh, don't do that, that's dangerous, that's scary, don't get hurt. But instead, she popped back with, well, that's one way to get down from a plane. Didn't see that coming. So Mom's always full of surprises. Another thing I admire about Mom is her strength. The dancing definitely made her strong physically, but her greatest strength was her will and determination. Needless to say, it was a great source of frustration when I was a teenager. It kind of made her feel a little inflexible and unwielding. But as I became an adult and became a mother of my own three beautiful babies, I realized that it was perhaps her superpower and a gift. She taught us to be independent with strong morals and values and never expect anything less from the people you surround yourself with. Always stand up for what you believe in and never give up. Those lessons raised 5 wonderful children, which blossomed into a more amazing family of their own. And we have continued to pass that on to their children and so forth. I'm so proud to be a part of my big, beautiful family. Mom and Dad may no longer be with us, but they have left me with a family who love and respect one another. Without a doubt, I know on any given day, I can ask for help, and I know my family will be beside me, lifting me up. Mom's zest and enthusiasm for life is like no other person I've ever met. She may have been 92 years old, but when she passed, her heart was young and fun. Each year, when my brother Terry would celebrate his birthday, he would say, "Mom, I'm older than you now." And it's true. I mean, like, even my friends, when we were in New Mexico, I'm like, "Hey, anybody want to go out dancing with me, Mom? And me? You know, come on, come on." They're like, "Oh, I'm so tired, and she likes to stay out late." She was truly, truly our dancing queen, having the time of her life. No better sign than that for Mom. I'm not sure how she did it, but she went line dancing sometimes 4 times a week, every week, up until our mid-80s. And she didn't go to a senior citizen place during the day, no, because that was the old people. She didn't like that. She would hit the nightlife of Roanoke until wee hours of the morning, especially if they were live music. She taught me age truly is a frame of mind, and you're only as old as you feel. One time, Mom was leaving her nightclub, and she was pulled over by a police officer, and Mom went to dance. She didn't go drinking or anything. She just went for dancing. So the police officer, of course, it's like 2 in the morning, is thinking, "Oh, I got me a drunk driver," you know, kind of thing. So he pulls her over because she yielded to a stop sign versus stopping all the way. But the police officer was quite surprised when she pulled out her driver's license with a 1928 birth date. And he was all, "Wait, is this right?" And she said, "Yes, but whatever you do, don't tell anyone back at the club because they think I'm younger than them." So needless to say, she did not get a ticket. She could talk her way out of anything. But he thought he was very impressed, and he was just like, "Okay, go on. Have a good day." Another time that I went dancing with her, and I'm like, "Mom, you ready to leave?" Mainly because I was tired. And she replied, "Why? It's only 1 a.m. Why can't we stay a little longer?" Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. No matter where we went, she was always the hit of the dance floor, and everyone loved dancing with her, especially me. One of the songs in the video, you guys probably watched multiple times, but I love that video. Is one of the songs is Ed Sheeran, and it reminds me so much of her. He said, "A heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved." So I know I've definitely been loved. And he also says, "A life with love is a life that has been lived." And Mama definitely lived life to the fullest. I love you, Mama. I'm already missing you like crazy. But I know you're happily in the arms of Daddy, dancing for eternity, and you'll always be in my heart.
Was blind.
Allow themselves to become vulnerable. A lot of times it takes a lot more strength to do that. than it does to put up a facade that everything's together all the time. And so as I thought about one of the strongest people that I can think of in the Bible is a fellow that he's in the Old Testament, and as you begin to read about him in 1 Samuel, you find out that he starts out as just a shepherd boy. And he's looking after sheep. And sheep are, if there's any animal that needs the most amount of care, it's sheep. Sheep can't do anything for themselves. They are most dependent on their shepherd. And David was a shepherd in his younger years. And matter of fact, while he was a shepherd, he went to visit his brothers who were on the front lines fighting the Philistines. And there was a giant named Goliath that was intimidating the armies of Israel. And they sure enough were intimidated, and nobody was willing to fight him. And as David went to the front lines to bring his brothers some lunch, some food, and to find out how they were doing, he looked at that giant and the strong-willed individual that he was, and seemingly to be on the outside, a very independent kind of a guy, he looked up at that big old guy and he said, "You're no battle for me." And so as I paraphrase, he reached down and grabbed a slingshot, a few small stones, and he slung his slingshot, hit him right in the forehead and killed the giant. He was a giant killer. But first he says, you know, the Lord help me. I first, as a shepherd, I killed a bear, and then I slayed the lion, and you're no match for me, and so I'm going to kill you too. And so he was a man of strength. He learned to depend upon his skills and the strength that he had. But no doubt later on in life, as he became a king, he became known as a strong king. He was a victorious king. The boundaries of Israel expanded to a greater extent than they've ever been before. And he was a very prosperous king. He was very, very popular. He had fame. He had fortune. He had a lot of things going for him. But what's interesting, the psalm that I'm going to read to you is a psalm that probably every one of you have heard. It's one of the most familiar passages that's in the Bible. But what this psalm reveals to us is this picture of this strong person, whether it be of a King David or whether it be of your mother or your grandmother, who is a strong person, this fun-loving person all their life. There is that part where it's important for us to acknowledge our weaknesses and be vulnerable, and that's exactly what King David does in the 23rd Psalm. He addresses God as the Lord. That's the greatest title that you can assign to God. That's the Lord. That's the most reverent, most awesome assignment title that you can assign to Him. He's bigger than anyone else. He's greater than anyone else. He is the Lord of Lords. He's the King of Kings. He is the Yahweh. But then he goes so far as to say that the Lord is my shepherd. He's my shepherd. You see, there's a lot of us have heard the 23rd Psalm, and we're familiar with the 23rd Psalm, but it's one thing to know the Psalm, and it's another thing to know the shepherd. And it's obvious that David knew the shepherd. Because what's interesting, when you know God as your shepherd, then that means that's saying something about yourself. I'm one of the sheep. And like I said a little bit earlier, there's no one that is more dependent on their leader than a sheep is. The sheep depend completely upon the shepherd to feed them, to keep them safe, to protect them. They cannot defend for themselves. And they, in a lot of ways, they're referred to as just being dumb and stupid. And they do stupid things. And I don't know about you, but I can identify with that a lot. I need help in life. I need strength in life. And I guess that if there's one thing that I'd like for you to kind of take away with you as a result of this service, and as a result of reflecting on your mother, your grandmother, your in-law life, and that is, yes, it's important to be strong in life. It's important to be strong-willed, as long as that will is surrendered to the Lord, and that we find ourselves you might say, independently dependent upon Jesus. Listen to what he says. The Lord is my shepherd, and because of that I shall not want. That's contentment. Contentment that's found in a relationship. And how wonderful it is when people get to the point in life when they realize that there's nothing in this life, no material thing, no physical thing that can offer you that contentment in life. It's not a matter of acquiring more. It's a matter of having more of Him and that relationship with Him. So he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Then he goes on, he says, he makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. I don't know what comes to your mind. Obviously, he's speaking about the relationship that he has with the Lord as a relationship that's meeting his needs. And he's speaking metaphorically here, because if there's anything that sheep are going to love, and that's going to be green pastures. It's in green pastures where they feel safe. It's in green pastures where they're fed. It's in green pastures where they can lie down and rest. I don't know where your green pastures are. I know what I found my green pastures. I found my green pastures as I spend time alone with the Lord, as I read His Word and He speaks to me, and I nurture that relationship with Him. And all the world around us can kind of be falling apart, and what kind of life we've had in 2020. It's been a world of chaos, it's been a world of confusion, and it's in so many ways a mess. But when you've got a relationship with the Lord, you can be strong in Him. You can be strong in facing those things because you're vulnerable in the relationship with the Lord, and you recognize that it's Him that you get your strength. He makes you lie down in green pastures, and He leads you beside the still waters. If there's anything that we need in life, it's something that can feed our soul. It's something that can quench that thirst that we have, that nothing in this world can quench, except that relationship with God through Christ. And he goes on, he says, He restores my soul. He works on the inside. Christianity is not a religion that's on the outside. It's a relationship that restores who you are from the inside out. And he goes on, he says, He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. For we can thank God for the direction and the decisions that He offers, helps us with in life as He guides us down those paths of righteousness. Those paths of righteousness are doing the right thing. And not only before man, but doing the right thing in the eyes of God. And it's so difficult sometimes to know what the right thing to do is. But when we depend upon Him, we find ourselves vulnerable before Him and depending on Him and asking for help, He guides us and He restores our soul. Even when those pathways are down tough pathways. He says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For Thou art with me, Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. The life of a Christian is not an easy life. It's not an insulated life. It's a life that's going to deal with loss. It's going to be a life that deals with pain. It's going to be a life that deals with suffering. But the thing that we have is a relationship that will go with us. And even though we walk through that valley of the shadow of death, we won't have to fear because He'll be with us. What a great relationship there is to find in Jesus Christ. And I guess that would be the thing that I want you to leave with today. You've had a great relationship with your mother, with your grandmother, with your mother-in-law. You've had a great relationship with her. But don't let it stop there. Have a relationship with Christ. He's the one that will never leave you. He's the one that death will not separate you from. He's the one that will give you the victory over every enemy that you ever have, whether it be the lion or whether it be the bear or whether it be the giants that you face. He's the one that gives you victory. He's the one that gives you rest. He's the one that gives you contentment. Take Him with you. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What a great promise. What a great blessing. I'm going to close with prayer, and then we're going to listen to just one stanza of He Lives. And then upon the second stanza, we'll exit as we think about that living Savior that we serve. and we can enjoy a relationship with them. God, thank you. And Father, in your grace and in your mercy and in your wisdom, God, you give to us parents that are strong and faithful and dependable. And God, ones that can give us great memories and be great role models for us, and one that particularly has a passion for living. And Father, we thank you for that, and what a great blessing that is. But thank you, Father, that your plan and your will for our life does not stop there. God, thank you that you give to us one who will never leave us, that death will not separate us from. But Father, you give to us a great shepherd of the sheep, the good shepherd. It's Jesus who lays down his life for the sheep. And we thank you for that. And we thank you, Father, that not only did he die on the cross to forgive us of our sins, but God, you reached down by your power and you took him out of the grave. And Father, it is that Savior who lives today. And we serve him today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, I need to go ask about that earring.
I'll take it.